25. After the meeting. Say it again.
Is it loud enough?
No.
Audrey, can we get it up a little louder?
Okay. Terrific.
Is that better?
Yeah.
Okay. Is it good enough?
Say more, say more.
Little more. Now?
That sounds good.
Okay, good. Let's bring it up here. Okay. Good evening. Welcome. I'm Mike Aramon, President of Squirrel Hill Historical Society. We welcome you to what must be about our 110th meeting of this group. We do this 11 months of the year. Our programs are always free, and you have a schedule on your chair, so we hope you keep coming. And we'll be here every month, snow allowing, till next August. We are a membership organization with 501(c)(3). If you want to donate, it's deductible. Your dues are deductible. I want to, first of all, introduce the members of the board of the group. We have our two vice presidents here, Helen Wilson, she's right there. Betty Connolly is sitting in the room over there. We also have Evelyn Young, our treasurer, is here. Where's Evelyn? There's Evelyn. And then we have board members, Audrey Glickman at the camera, and Ralph Lund is here as well. A couple of our board members are missing tonight. We're totally, and the website coordinator, Patricia, is in the back.
Yes.
Speaking of which, many of you have used our website. That's Pat News, by the way. I get seen in moments sometimes. Many of you use our website. Expect some substantial changes in the new year. We're in the midst of upgrading and expanding that website. But as you know, we already have all of our programs, or many of our programs, recorded there. You can look at them if you missed something from the last 7 years. A lot of other information. Also, we have a regular exhibit now at the Squirrel Hill Library, and it's just been changed. Helen Wilson has just upgraded it to be the Bridges of Pittsburgh, which goes along with a book that is available for sale tonight here that she and her son and other folks put together. That book was featured in Shady Avenue this week. So was our library exhibit. So consider buying the book, but also go over and see the exhibit. We are a membership group committed to education and outreach. That costs some money. And we have put a book out called Squirrel Hill some years ago, made a lot of money on royalties. We don't get those anymore, so membership dues are in fact very important to us. Those of you who would like to join, you can say postage by doing it tonight. Those of you who have joined for the new year and still have a sheet on your chair, we're not asking you to join again. I just couldn't distinguish who's going to sit where. So in any event, we hope that you will rejoin us. But you can come to meetings free anyway, okay? We're very happy about our speaker tonight for a number of reasons, including the fact that despite many of us in this room being very big sports enthusiasts, we haven't really had a lot of programs on sports. So Pat Farabaugh was going to speak tonight at his behest. He volunteered. He called us one day to say he had the topic he's going to talk about tonight that he wanted to share with us. And he's come down from Loretto, from Edinburgh, from Edinburgh, from St. Francis, to come and speak tonight about two very interesting basketball players. Very few of us in the room know much at all about the story we're going to hear tonight. Pat's been a professor at St. Francis and has been involved in athletic media. Maybe he can say a little more about himself, but I'm very happy to bring Pat up to speak.
I
thank you, Mike, and thank you to the other officers and the folks he introduced for having me here. Thank you to the great turnout for this event. As Mike mentioned, I did reach out to him. This is a it was a labor that I really enjoyed in putting this book together. And when I get the chance to talk about it out in the Pittsburgh area, I jump at it because these are two amazing men that history didn't forget, but they I don't think that people quite understand the qualities of the two men that I'm going to talk about, and that being Maurice Stokes and Jack Twyman. As Mike mentioned, my background is in working in athletic public relations. I actually was an intern long ago at the University of Pittsburgh. I've worked at Slippery Rock University and sports information, Bucknell University. I was the sports information director at St. Francis University, and talking to a few folks about the catalyst for writing this book, I arrived at St. Francis in 1999 and was the sports information director for the university that I teach at now as a faculty member in the communications department. I was there from 99 to 05, and we retired Maurice's jersey at St. Francis, and I got to know Jack and Carol Twyman in coordinating that event. And then Maurice, through Jack's efforts, although he was very deserving of it, he went into the Naismith Hall of Fame while I was sports information director there. And Jack Twyman accepted the jacket that they give to, and the plaque that they give to the recipients, then donated it back to our university. And when I was sports information director, I had grown up in that area. I'm a basketball nut. I love basketball. And can't wait until the season gets rolling here in about a week. It's hard to believe it's getting started this soon with still playing football to be played. But I went back to school. I went back to Penn State, got my doctoral degree, taught at a couple other schools, and then was blessed to have the opportunity to come back to St. Francis in my fifth year on the faculty there. But after I finished my dissertation, which was my first book, it was not nearly as enjoyable read as this. It was on FCC telecommunications policy, so I don't present on that. But as soon as I finished that, I'm like, I want to get into this project. It was something that I really thought it was a story that needed to be told. I called Jack Twyman, and I said to him, hey, this is something I wanted, and I had mentioned it to him before. I said, this is something I want to do. I'm going to try to give you a picture of who he was. Some people say they don't want attention, and yet they say it tongue-in-cheek. They don't mind when that attention comes their way. Jack Twyman, what he did for Maurice, which I'm going to talk about tonight, he did not want, he didn't want his praises sung. He didn't want the notoriety of the guy that helped Maurice Stokes out. He wanted to stay below the radar, and he was real leery about working on this book with me. So we worked out an agreement. I'm like, look, Jack, you can choose not to answer questions, but if you can cooperate with me on this, and that was the summer of 2010. He agreed to do it. We had some extensive interview sessions, and then he died. He contracted a fast-moving cancer of the blood. He died in May of 2012. And his funeral was in early June out in Cincinnati. So I hope I give you an impression of who Maurice is. It's a biography on him, but as you can see, part of the title, Jack Twyman, is also included in there. And it's the story of both these men, and especially how Jack stepped up for Maurice. I have copies, and I'm happy to... They're $25. I'm happy to sign any copies if you're interested in picking up a copy after the presentation. So, we're here in Squirrel Hill, and I want to talk to you about his formative years growing up here. His parents, Taro and Myrtle Stokes, were Virginia natives, and they relocated to western Pennsylvania during the 1920s. They did not know each other. They met here in western Pennsylvania. Taro had come looking for work. They lived in Braddock and then moved to Rankin, Tara worked as a foundry worker. This is Maurice's father, in the Jones and Laughlin Steel Company in Braddock. And then he took a job at the Edgar Thompson Steelworks in North Braddock. Maurice, when he was five, the family moved to Homewood, the northern section of Homewood. His address was 534 Carl Street. He attended Crescent Elementary School, six blocks from the family's home, and also Baxter Junior High. He visited G.C. Murphy's, the Belmar Theater on Homewood Avenue. He swam the Baxter Pool on Brushton Avenue. A quote from John Brewer, who I interviewed for this book, just about an encounter with Maurice. One of the Stokes family neighbors was John Brewer. He recalled an encounter one morning with Maurice. "I was greeted by a giant while collecting for the paper route," said Brewer. "He stooped under the door frame of the side porch door as I backed away. My thoughts were instantly racing to decide if he was the jolly tan giant or Thor, a comic book character. I was speechless." "You collecting?" he replied with a surprisingly soft, low voice. I just stared. Maurice was one of four children to Taro and Myrtle Stokes. He had a twin sister, Clarice, and he was very protective of Clarice. He entered Westinghouse High School in the fall of 1947. The head football coach, Pete D'Imperio, was eyeing him as a football player. His brother, Harry, his two older brothers, Maurice and Clarice, are the youngest of this Taro and Myrtle's four children. Taro's still alive, Taro Jr. actually, in the Chicago area. I talked to him for this book. Harry, his brother, was a very good football player at Westinghouse. He went on and played college football at Lincoln College in Missouri. And Pete D'Imperio, who, if you're familiar with high school football in this area, he ran a single wing offense, tremendous success. He was eyeing Stokes to follow in Harry's footsteps. But Stokes didn't play football. He wanted to forge his own way, and basketball was his sport. He played basketball for the Bulldogs, for Willard Fisher, was his coach there. In 1949-50, Maurice's junior year, he and Ed Fleming and a guy by the name of Jack Nunlist, they led the Bulldogs to a city championship, and then they won a second straight city championship in 1950-51. They beat Carrick. They lost to Farrell in the playoffs in that year, 55-54. The Steelers' star player, Farrell Steelers' star player, was a guy named Julius McCoy. Some of you fans might remember. He became an All-American at Michigan State. So a little bit more about his experiences here. One of his mentors that he had growing up in Homewood was Chuck Cooper, who was the first black starter at Duquesne in Duquesne basketball history. And this is an aside, but I also am the play-by-play announcer for St. Francis football, and if we beat Robert Morris Saturday, we'll be at Duquesne in 2 weeks for the Northeast Conference Championship on the line. So feel free to go over to Duquesne on the 21st for the St. Francis Duquesne game. Chuck Cooper, he was the first player drafted in the NBA by the Celtics in 1950. And he was a black starter at Duquesne. And he was one of the mentors for Maurice and Ed Fleming. This is another excerpt from the book. I'm just going to read a few of these. With regards to Stokes and Fleming looking up to him and the games that were played at Mellon Park, Fleming would often borrow Chuck Cooper's Oldsmobile convertible, pick up Stokes, and head for Mellon Park. And while the two Westinghouse standouts were regulars at the park, Jack Twyman essentially lived there during the summer of 1950. He would pack sandwiches for lunch and dinner and was often the first player to arrive each morning and the last to leave each night. "I was there from 8 a.m. to 9 p.m., said Twyman. I'd get up at 6 a.m. to go to Mellon on time. College coaches also found their way to Mellon Park, and built relationships with the players. Vendors sold flavored ice balls and popcorn to spectators who gathered to view the action. The games would go on all day, said Twyman. You try to put together a team that stayed on the court for most of the day. You went back home at night, came back the next day, and did the same thing all over again. And then another quote from Brewer, just the congregation of players. Young guys like me, he was younger than Stokes and Twyman and Ed Fleming, and certainly Cooper. Young guys like me had to arrive at 8 in the morning to get on the court, said Brewer. When the big guys arrived, we had to get off. Ed Fleming was very physical and liked to use his long elbows to keep defenders off him. Maurice was more of a smooth, natural shooter who was always in the paint for the rebound. Everybody moved so fast you could barely see who had the ball. We stood on the sidelines and studied our elders, said Brewer. Players like Stokes and Fleming seemed to glow. Mack Park, which is located on the corner of 5th and Penn Avenues and borders East Liberty, Squirrel Hill, and Shadyside, was the gathering place for these tremendous basketball players. Cooper, Dick Grote, who announces Pitt basketball, now of course the great Pirate, but was an All-American basketball player at Duke. John Brisker, Connie Hawkins, Walt Tatum, John Weidman, these big names in basketball, they gathered at Mellon Park to play in these games. So Stokes had success, and that's a picture of him and Ed Fleming when they were at Westinghouse together. Jack Twyman, he had a little tougher road to hoe. He was a Central Catholic high school basketball player. He was cut from his, he was a late bloomer. He was cut from his Central Catholic team as a freshman, as a sophomore, and as a junior. Jack Twyman, and I remember his children at his funeral in June of 2012, just talked about the stick-to-itiveness and the work ethic that he had instilled in his children. He went up to the coach for Central and told him after his junior year, he served as a manager and played for the Apaches because he wasn't able to make his high school team. He said, "You won't be able to cut me next year." And then he went to Mellon Park all summer, worked on his game. As a senior, he led the Vikings to the Pittsburgh Catholic League. They never played one of them because Westinghouse was a city school, public school, and Central Catholic was a Catholic League school, but he led them to the finals and the state semifinals, actually. Easter break of their senior year for Maurice and Jack, they got to know each other on the court at Mellon Park, weren't close. Duty Moore, who was a coach, successful coach at Duquesne, he invited Fleming and Twyman, who were both seniors, Fleming and Stokes and Jack Twyman and a handful of other guys to work out, and they actually thumped the regulars for the Dukes pretty good at this quote-unquote tryout, and he offered to all three of those guys on the spot scholarships if they came to Duquesne. Twyman accepted the offer. Fleming ended up going to Niagara University in upstate New York, and Stokes, and we're going to get to how he matriculated to St. Francis, nifty work behind the scenes by their coach, Skip Hughes. Twyman initially accepted the offer to go to play for Duty Moore at Duquesne, but the football coach at Central Catholic had some ties at Cincy. He's like, Jack said, "No, I'm going to Duquesne." And he goes, "Well, just go out and visit the University of Cincinnati and see what you think." Twyman went out and just fell in love with the place, had struck up a good rapport with the coach, came back and told Moore that he was going to go to the University of Cincinnati. So Fleming's headed for Niagara, Twyman's going to Cincy, and Maurice Stokes ends up at the school that I work at, which is St. Francis University. Interestingly, Skip Hughes, who was a dentist in Hollidaysburg, Pennsylvania, which is in Blair County, not far from St. Francis, about a half hour. He was the basketball coach, and he didn't feel like he was going to be able to get Stokes to come out to this mountain campus. Has anyone in here ever been to St. Francis University? So I mean, you know, we're pretty rural, and we were pretty white at the time. There weren't many African Americans in the mountains of Cambria County. And so Skip Hughes wanted to get Maurice Stokes. He saw the potential. So he recruited a teammate of Stokes by the name of Eugene Phelps, who played at Westinghouse. And Jean came to St. Francis a semester before Maurice. Skip Hughes knew they were very close. Jean was a good player in his own right, but he also knew that having someone on campus that was a good friend of Maurice's might lure him there. And so Maurice ultimately, in large part because of, well, he was a regular at the Carl, at the home of the Stokes, visiting throughout the summer, but ultimately bringing Eugene Phelps to St. Francis in advance of Maurice was what got him there. We were a small school at the time, and the NCAA allowed freshmen. At most schools, freshmen were not allowed to play, but because St. Francis was so small, if you had a certain enrollment, you were allowed to play as a freshman. So he played for the varsity as a freshman in 51-52. And again, I'm not going to get too stat heavy. There's quite a few numbers up there. I'm not going to read through them all. As a sophomore in 52-53, you see a lot fewer games. Skip Hughes, the coach for St. Francis, had a very difficult time getting teams on the schedule Maurice's sophomore year because this 6'8", 230-pound rebounding scoring machine came out of nowhere, and teams were like, you know, thanks, but we'll pass. And so had a real difficult time putting a schedule together and actually hurt chances, the chances for St. Francis to go to a postseason opportunity. His junior year, just a breakout year. These are pretty, again, the PPG stands for points per game and rebounds per game. That's to average more than 20 rebounds per game for a college game is just a remarkable number. 20-5. Duquesne had a powerhouse program at the time. Duty Moore had Cy Hugo Green, Dick Ricketts, just tremendous, tremendous players. St. Francis was competing with Duquesne and other programs. They hadn't beaten Duquesne up until Stokes' senior year, in which they will, but they were competing. Tiny little St. Francis, Maurice Stokes' junior year, gets an invitation to the NIT, which is the National Invitation Tournament. And at the time, the NCAA tournament, the Big Dance, was on the rise. But the NIT tournament at this time, in the early first half of the 50s, still carried a lot of weight. I don't want to say that whose champion would have won. Certainly Bill Russell and the University of San Francisco, their run of success, and they went to the NCAAs. But the NIT was much more on par with the NCAA tournament. Unlike today, where it's clearly a second tournament, everyone wants to go to the Big Dance. St. Francis gets an invitation to the National Invitation Tournament, Madison Square Garden. And Maurice Stokes takes them into the garden. They knock off Brigham Young University with a huge game by Maurice. And then they take on Duty Moore's Duquesne team, and they lose in a pretty tightly contested game by 6 points. Maurice is named to the National Invitation Tournament team, again, a tremendous, tremendous rebounder. Was really strong, had leaping ability, set a single season record for all colleges. And incidentally, when they were at Madison Square Garden, people had fun with this tiny school from the middle of nowhere that no one really knew about. It wasn't a school that people... Not like Long Island University with Claire B. and Duquesne University with Duty Moore. These were known commodities, and all of a sudden this dentist coach has this this guy in the middle. And so anyway, the Madison Square Garden fans, they latched on to St. Francis, and they began to make them their favorite if they didn't have a team in the game. So his senior year, and that's a photo of Maurice with his mother, Myrtle, and his niece, one of Clarice's daughters, on his graduation day on our campus. As a senior in 54-55, 21-7, big numbers in terms of scoring and rebounding. Another National Invitation Tournament berth, and St. Francis goes and makes some noise this time. They beat Seton Hall, they beat Holy Cross. Tom Heinsohn played for Holy Cross at the time. They lose in the semifinals to Bill Ull and the Dayton team in overtime. These are Maurice's numbers, 43 points in that game against Dayton, over half the team's points in a loss to Dayton in the semifinals. And then the losers of the semifinal game go and play in a consolation game. And so Duquesne, which won the national invitation tournament that year, defeated Cincy in the other semifinal game, and Duquesne would go on to beat Dayton and be the NIT champs. St. Francis takes on the University of Cincinnati. That's where Jack Twyman is, and he's a senior as well, in 54-55. An amazing game. That's a triple-double, double figures in three statistical categories for Maurice, but Jack Twyman's team wins the game in overtime. The crowds in these games, again, it was really pro St. Francis, and talking to people from my book on the tournament, they recollect the fans just embracing the tiny school from Western Pennsylvania, and the newspaper stories reflected that. They talked about Maurice Stokes and his maybe not so skilled but spunky cohorts, used that kind of language to describe St. Francis. So St. Francis finishes fourth. Duquesne wins at Dayton, obviously the runner-up. They lost to the Dukes. Cincy finishes third. St. Francis was fourth. And yet, even though they finished fourth, Maurice was voted the most valuable player of the entire tournament. And it was a unanimous vote by the writers who did that. He's, to this day, the only player from a fourth-place team to ever win the MVP award. He earns All-American honors. And those were his averages for his collegiate career. In this season, St. Francis did finally have Duquesne's number. We played them at the Cambria County War Memorial in January of 1955, and St. Francis knocked off Duty Moore's Dukes that year. And interestingly, Duquesne was number two in the country behind Kentucky at the time, and Kentucky lost that same week. And the Dukes would have ascended to that top spot had they not lost to St. Francis. And I'm really excited. The two teams are going to rematch. We're going to play at the Cambria County War Memorial a game in December against Duquesne, an off-campus game coming up next month. So Maurice Stokes is drafted into the NBA. Now, this is not LeBron James NBA. This is a league that's very much in its infancy. It was the consolidation of two smaller leagues, but this is 1954-55, and the Rochester Royals, which were one of the ancestors of the current Sacramento Kings. A guy by the name of Les Harrison owns the Rochester Royals, and with the second pick of the draft, he picks up Maurice Stokes out of St. Francis. Stokes had other opportunities. Abe Saperstein, who ran the Globetrotters, he had worked for Abe for a couple of summers. Saperstein was no dummy. He tried to get summer jobs for guys that were good players to try to lure them to join his team. He and Maurice putting floors down between his junior and his senior years. But he turned down a lucrative contract at the time from Saperstein. Also turned down the Industrial Basketball League teams that were after him. Les Harrison, the owner of the Royals, took Stokes in the first round. He took Jack Twyman from Cincinnati in the second round. And he took Ed Fleming in the third round, his former teammate at Westinghouse. Jack told me the story. They all got piled into Jack's car, leaving Pittsburgh in the summer of 1955, headed to Rochester together, looking forward to the opportunity in the National Basketball Association. Takes on the Knicks in Rochester. In his pro debut, those were the numbers he put up, 32 points, 20 rebounds, and 8 assists. And he didn't continue at that pace, but had a great, great season. So good that he was named the Rookie of the Year, the top player in the league. Earned second-team All-League honors. Led the team in scoring and rebounding. And for NBA fans, Bob Pettit is a name that is very much, people are familiar with. He finished second behind Pettit in rebounding. that 55-56 season. Twyman played well, but didn't make the splash that Maurice did in their first year. Ed Fleming, not quite the success that either Stokes or Twyman enjoyed that year. Second season, again, very successful. 17.4 rebounds per game. That was really Stokes' specialty. He didn't have particularly the greatest shot in the world. It was a little bit flat. He was also a very good passer. And this time in basketball, big men, they scored. Bob Pettit didn't look to pass much. Maurice Stokes and the national media, when they played, when St. Francis played the National Invitation Tournament, Maurice Stokes was a forerunner, a pioneer in big men who passed the basketball well. If a double team came and collapsed on him, he was always looking for the open man. And so he was really, and some of the New York writers, when they lost to Dayton, they talked about how Maurice Stokes kept passing the ball out to his St. Francis teammates who would proceed to miss the shot. And they asked him, why did you keep passing it to your teammates? And he said, well, if I'm double-teamed, do the math. Somebody's open. And he was like that in the National Basketball Association as well. A big man to finish third in the league was really, they were all small guards that were distributing the ball. He broke the single-season rebounding record that had been set by Bob Pettit. In the 1957 NBA All-Star Game, he had a really big game. Unfortunately for him, it was in Boston at the Garden, and the Boston Red Sox gave it to Bob Cousy, their point guard, even though Cousy even admitted that it probably should have gone to Maurice Stokes in a showdown with Bob Pettit, went over 30 in points and rebounds, second team All-League, fifth in the league's MVP voting. Okay, his third year, and this would be his final year in the league. The team relocated Rochester, the Rochester Warren, and I was just in Rochester about a month and a half ago and delivered a presentation there. Actually, Skip Hughes' daughter, Diane Dickman, who lives up there now, she came to the event. This was kind of neat. I'd done a lot of research at the Central Library in downtown Rochester, and they were gracious enough to have me up to talk about the book. But Rochester wasn't drawing. Les Harrison couldn't fill the War Memorial. And Jack Twyman, who had played at the University of Cincinnati and still had contacts there, he had suggested to Les, hey, why don't you reach out to the Cincinnati Gardens and see if you might be able to move the team to Cincinnati. A native Rochester, citizen of Rochester, Les Harrison was really leery, but he was losing money. The team was not... was not lucrative there for him. And so he did move the team before the 57-58 season, which was the third season for Stokes. Bill Russell was now in the league out of the University of San Francisco. And I talk about their battles in the book quite a bit, some real clashes between these two tremendous rebounders. So he finished second behind Bill Russell in the league in rebounding, again, third in assists, but behind two guards, Cousy and McGuire, averages just under 17 a game, second team All-NBA, accounted for much of the Royals' offense, and placed fifth in the league's MVP voting. So the season is winding down, his third season, and in the final regular season game, the Royals, the Cincinnati Royals now, it's a Wednesday, March 12, 1958. They're taking on the Minneapolis Lakers, who are now the Los Angeles Lakers. And Stokes has an accident. He gets tied up. Again, nothing malicious. A player for the Lakers by the name of Vern Mickelson, who died not long ago, a couple of years ago. Stokes drove to the basket. He and Mickelson got tied up, and Maurice crashed to the floor and hit his head off the back of his head off of the floor, and he was knocked unconscious, and he was down. There were no trainers. The coaches came out, and they put smelling salts under his nose. He went to the bench. His coach, Bobby Wanzer, who was a player coach for 2 years, and he was just only coaching this third and final season for Maurice. And Bobby's still alive, actually. He lives outside of Rochester. Had the pleasure of talking to him for the book. He said, Maurice came up to me and said, hey, I'm okay, I'm ready to go. And I looked at him, he looked okay, and they put him back in the game. Now, that would never happen today. With all of the concussion protocol, all of the precautionary measures that are being taken, the whole NFL situation with head trauma would have never happened today. This is a different era, though, and it's important for history to try to think about things in the time period in which you're writing. So Wanzer didn't think anything of it and put him back in the game. He finished with 24 points. They won the game. They clinch a playoff spot in this victory over Minneapolis. And this is a Wednesday, March 12th. They're going to play on March 15th, a Saturday afternoon, in a best of three series against Detroit. It's going to start in Detroit, a game Saturday in Detroit, a game Sunday in Cincinnati, and then a third game, if necessary, later in the week. So the team goes from directly from Minneapolis to Detroit, and Stokes isn't feeling well, and he gets nauseous when they arrive in Detroit. Wanzer said he didn't put the two together, that perhaps the nauseousness and the upset stomach and some of the headaches that Stokes was feeling, he didn't tie that to the accident. And partly because Clyde Lavellette, who was a big man on that team, and Jim Paxson, two players on the Royals, they were also nauseous, and he thought that they might have had food poisoning. Stokes wasn't able to sleep very well. He was really hot. They stayed at the Sheraton Hotel in Detroit, and he noted a couple of times he just had to open the windows to let cool air in. So they're not putting it together. And what's happening is Stokes has an injury in his brain. His brain is bleeding, and there's some swelling taking place from the fall against Minneapolis. So in this first game of the playoffs, and this is the first opportunity Stokes had to participate in the playoffs, he scored a dozen points, grabbed 15 rebounds, but he wasn't himself. Some of the players who played in that game, he was a pretty fluid player, and he could also handle the basketball. Very good ball handler. He was a big man. Skip Hughes for St. Francis would often let him bring the ball up the court. Again, very unusual. 6'8", inside player, handling the ball as much as Maurice did. But he was bungling passes, not himself, to people who participated in that game that Detroit won. George Ardley played for Detroit, and he was their big player. He had a good game that day. So anyway, they're going back. So that's Saturday afternoon. They go back to the hotel, pack their stuff up, and head for the airport. The commissioner of the league, Maurice Podoloff, is also traveling with the team, and Les Harrison is there, Bobby Wanzer, the coach. They get to the airport in Cincinnati, and Stokes just doesn't look good. He goes into the bathroom, relieves himself several times, and some guys say, hey, and they called him Mo. They said, hey, Mo, why don't you just stay here? The game's not until early afternoon. Catch a flight back to Cincinnati Sunday morning and just try to feel better. And he was like, no, the doctors are there. Our team doctor is in Cincinnati. He can check on me. And so he decided he was going to try to make a go of getting back to Cincinnati. It wasn't a long flight. He made the decision ultimately to get on the plane. So they get on the plane, and you know how when you get on a plane, your ears pop, that air cabin pressure. What happened was that exacerbated what was going on in his head. The swelling increased. He began sweating profusely. Jack told me, Jack Twyman, in talking about what happened that night, he said he had a tweed sports coat on. He said you could have taken that thing off and took it over a sink and wrung it out. It was that just heavy with sweat. He began bleeding from his ears, from his mouth. His breathing became shallow. Gene Phillips, a flight attendant on the flight, gave him oxygen. They attributed that to saving his life. Phlegm was developing in the back of his throat, so he was finding it very, very difficult to breathe. As I mentioned, they called it the president of the league at the time, Maurice Potteloff, was on the flight along with Les Harrison. And those two and Bobby Wanser, the coach, they talked about what should they do. Should they turn the flight around, go back to Detroit, or should they proceed on to Cincinnati? Because this happened pretty quickly in the flight. And the decision was ultimately made, hey, there's a hospital in northern Kentucky close to the Cincinnati airport. We're going to get there. It'll take less time to get him into a hospital if we continue on to Cincinnati. So that was the decision. Doctors, after the fact, said it was the right one. They get on the ground. It was a rainy night. Some of the guys remembered. The ambulance was waiting. They radioed ahead. They said, hey, we have a really sick player on this plane who's going to need to be rushed to the hospital. So they rush him to St. Elizabeth's Hospital and gets there shortly before midnight. Really unclear if he was going to make it through the night. I was actually administered last rites at the hospital. And again, what had happened was his brain from that fall on Wednesday night against Minneapolis, the brain was swelling. And the air cabin pressure worsened the condition. And that swelling shut down his motor system, his ability to walk, his ability to talk, to have control. It shut down. Now, his brain was sharp. He didn't lose any of his intellect, his intelligence, that all remained intact, but he was essentially paralyzed from the neck down. Initially misdiagnosed, by the way. He was diagnosed with encephalitis, which they thought was viral, as opposed to the trauma that he experienced when his head hit the floor. He fell into a coma when he arrived at St. Elizabeth's, and didn't emerge from that coma for a three-week period. And he wrote about this. I interviewed his speech therapist, a woman by the name of Sylvia Meek. And Sylvia would write down, he would keep a log about some of his experiences. She would write down the stories that Maurice shared. And I used entries from his journal in putting together this story. When he emerged from his coma, he talked about, he saw Ed Fleming in the room, he saw his parents, or not his father, but his mother was there, his sister Clarice was there, and he tried to speak and nothing came out. So, Sotero and Myrtle Stokes, they're not a family of means, they were very much working class. He was already in the hospital for 3 weeks, and Jack recalled an occasion where he saw Myrtle Stokes, and she just had a really resigned expression, very, very somber. And Jack went and talked to her, and he said, and she just expressed to him they weren't sure what they were going to do. It was becoming increasingly clear that this was going to be a long-term proposition for their son, who's only 24 years old. And how were they going to pay the bills? They didn't know. These medical bills were already mounting. And so Jack Twyman, and this is, you have to think about, he's also 24 years old at the time. Now, when I was 24 years old, I was still pretty irresponsible. Jack Twyman said to Myrtle, and he's starting a family of his own. He met his wife Carol at the University of Cincinnati, and they had a couple of small children. He asked if he could assume responsibility for Stokes' finances. He wanted to help him. And the other thing is they weren't particularly close. Even, I mentioned they played ball together in the summers at Mellon Park. When they were playing with the Royals, they weren't all that close in terms of being close friends. Most of the, and there weren't very many, but the members of the team that were black, they spent time together, and the members of the team that were white spent time together. This is the 1950s, and it wasn't a case where there was a lot of fraternizing between these two men. Jack, however, lived in Cincinnati, and Paxson also lived there. There were the only two players who made their homes in Cincinnati, so they actually, that game that Sunday game, they lost to Detroit, and everybody went home. And so Jack is in Cincinnati. Maurice is in a hospital in Cincinnati. And so he began to visit him regularly. He asked saw his mother, asked if he could become his guardian. Myrtle Stokes and Tara Stokes agreed to it, and he was appointed his legal guardian. Doctors did determine or concluded that, hey, this was not viral in nature, the accident, the coma that Maurice Stokes landed into and the ultimate paralysis. This was actually something they called post-traumatic encephalopathy, and this was triggered by the accident that occurred in Minneapolis on March 12th. And so Twyman said, well, hey, this is a workers' compensation case then. Maurice Stokes was on the job, hit his head. We can secure workers' compensation benefits for him to help pay some of these medical bills. And so he reached out to a lawyer friend in Ohio, pitched the idea, and he said, yeah, let's give it a go. And so it was the first workers' compensation case that anyone ever sought in the National Basketball Association, and they ultimately prevailed when the diagnosis was changed to head trauma suffered in that game in Minneapolis. They secured some money to help pay his bills. This was a neat story. Stokes had an insurance policy. He also had a bank account somewhere in Cincinnati, and Twyman literally went bank to bank to bank and told him who he was until he found this checking account that Maurice Stokes had. They went through that pretty quickly. Anyways, attorney friend Walter Beal, they applied for workers' compensation benefits. And it was the first occasion that anyone had done that for someone in professional sport, in professional basketball, and they ultimately prevailed. Ohio's state of Ohio picked up the cost of hospital nursing and therapeutic care. So in addition to assuming responsibilities for his finances, Twyman also sued the state of Ohio on behalf of Maurice. One of the stipulations in order to continue to receive workers' compensation benefits was that Maurice had to remain in Ohio. And so he was not taken back to this area in Pittsburgh where he was from. Talking about Oscar Robertson with a couple of folks beforehand, Oscar Robertson was, Twyman was a very good player at Cincinnati. Oscar Robertson is synonymous with Bearcat basketball, University of Cincinnati, and he would go on and play with the Royals and would become the president of the NBA Players Association and became friends with Stokes. He would go and visit Maurice, and Oscar is still alive. He was at the funeral out in Cincinnati, Jack Twyman's funeral, and lives in the Cincinnati area. But he used the story of Maurice Stokes to negotiate a stronger retirement plan, a benefits package, for a health benefits package for players in the NBA. And Twyman, this is a quote from Twyman just on how Maurice Stokes' story was a catalyst to a safety net in terms of an insurance, health benefits, a pension plan, and a minimum salary. And Oscar Robertson building that relationship with Maurice through Jack. Oscar and Jack played together with the Royals and got to know Maurice, and Oscar would use that story oftentimes as the president of the National Basketball Players Association. Hey, look at Maurice Stokes and what can happen, the risks that we take as players. And also, Jack Twyman talked to me about if Maurice had stayed healthy, it would have been those three men playing together for the Cincinnati Royals. And Jack insists, again, not a boastful guy, but he says that Bill Russell, Bob Cousy, Red Auerbach, the Celtics would not have had that dynasty run that they enjoyed if he really thinks the Royals would have at least won a championship or two during that period with those three men, with the playmaking ability of Oscar. Twyman was a shooter, and Stokes would kid him a little bit about he never saw a shot he didn't like. But Twyman or Stokes said, I don't mind because I'm a rebounder, so I just clean up Jack's misses. And he would actually, when he was in the hospital, Twyman would come to visit, and they had a sort of a needling personality. Stokes actually called him flaky because he would have some dandruff that would on his shoulders, so he would tease him. Twyman would come to the hospital, and Stokes would sort of critique. Stokes did gain the ability to speak. He spoke in a sort of a guttural way. I've seen some video of his speaking, and you had to be around him to understand it, but Jack did. But he would always critique Jack's performances when he'd come to visit him. So they had that a real sort of teasing in a almost in a brotherly way between the two of them. But there's no question that it was certainly, Stokes' story was certainly a catalyst to getting the pension plan, the benefits for NBA players that they enjoy today. This is another story of the kind of man that Jack Twyman is. The Broyles were playing, so Stokes fell in March of 58, so this is the first season that he's not a member of the team. And I should also note that this story did get national attention in, there was a story in Reader's Digest, Saturday Evening Post when this happened. Stokes was, the NBA was still in its infancy, but Stokes was a big enough name in the NBA, and it was such a tragic story that it did get some national exposure in magazines. And Stokes indicated in some of the publications, hey, I'll be back. He felt that this was, he would realize that it was a long-term proposition, that the improvements he made would be very minimal, but when he came out of the coma, he did think that he was going to find his way back to the league, his attitude. It became increasingly clear that he didn't, and he struggled with that. He fell into a pretty deep depression that Jack and others tried to help him out of. But anyway, the first season, the Stokes isn't with the Royals. The Royals are in Madison Square Garden playing the Knicks. And Haskell Cohen, who was the NBA's publicity director, and he has Duquesne ties as well, he came down to the locker room and he knew Twyman. He said, hey, Jack, I got somebody that I want you to meet. Or somebody who wants to meet you, actually. And a guy by the name of Milton Kutcher, who owned Kutcher's Country Club and Resort in the Catskill Mountains. The Borch Belt in the Catskills. Milton was one of the owners of one of the premier places up there. And he said, hey, I saw your story in one of the magazines, and I want to help this Stokes guy out. I have a resort. A lot of the players would go and play games in the Catskills at these various resorts. And he said, hey, why don't we have a benefit game? You come to my country club in the Catskills, and all the guys have to do is pay the way to get there. We'll put them up. We'll feed them. We'll have a benefit game. Whatever money you make, we'll give to help pay for Stokes' medical bills. So in August of 59, which is a year after they had talked, the first Stokes benefit game drew 70 players. Now, the league wasn't very big at the time, so that speaks to the sort of the kinship and the ways in which the NBA guys wanted to step up on behalf of their fallen teammate, and they raised $5,800 for Stokes' medical bills. Wilt Chamberlain was someone who was always made this a priority on his schedule. It was always in August, always the first week in August. Chamberlain was MVP of that game. The first Tuesday of each August, they played that game from 59. So Stokes fell in 58, the first game in August of 59. Until 1969, and raised, you know, that's a lot of money at that time period to help defray some of the costs of Stokes' medical expenses. The expenses were huge. He had a lot of therapy. He had speech therapy. He had physical therapy. He had occupational therapy, and the doctors talked about the zeal, the energy, and enthusiasm with which he approached his therapy, and also his attitude. He was depressed. He needed to come to terms with that the MBA wasn't going to be in his future, and he did. And he took the same sort of energy and enthusiasm that he had for basketball to his rehabilitation. They talk about he was at three different hospitals in the Cincinnati area, and Good Samaritan, St. Elizabeth, and Christ Hospital. And they talk about a number of stories, but one boy had dove into the shallow end of a pool and hit his head and suffered paralysis, and they couldn't get him to try to push himself, or at least even try in his physical therapy. And the doctors told his parents, why don't you take him to see Maurice Stokes? And Stokes built up a relationship with him, and eventually he said, I'll try rehab if Stokes is going to be there to watch me. And so he had sort of that that quality about him. He was very a very warm, soft-hearted person. And Twyman was a little bit different. Twyman was rougher around the edges than Maurice Stokes. So they were different in that regard. The nurses built relationships with Maurice. They talked about how he would make gifts for them. He would make ceramic ashtrays out of clay. It's just really a soft spot for the people that helped him. He tried. He really did. He worked with Sylvia Meek, his speech therapist, one of the people I interviewed for the book. He eventually, with very cumbersome leg braces, parallel bars, he could move across a room. But the improvements, he could speak a real guttural way. Improvements were really minimal. The damage had been done in that accident. And it's hard to say if precautions had been taken. If he hadn't got on that plane, if maybe they had transported him from Detroit to Cincinnati, ground transportation. It's all hindsight as to exactly what the extent of the damage would have been had they taken the precautions that they certainly would today. Now you do a baseline test, and then I just had a student, and she had to go through our concussion protocol at St. Francis, where, hey, you answer these questions on a test, and after you suffer a head injury, you have to answer the questions again, and then how much do your responses deviate from the scores? So to say that this wouldn't have happened had there been more precautions taken, perhaps. So the Stokes game was another way that Twyman demonstrated how much he cared. Chamberlain's commitment was something that was really set the tone for the other players in the league. The photos aren't reproducing great, but that's Roy Campanella next to Maurice. They built a relationship when Maurice fell that same winter. Roy Campanella was in a car accident, the catcher for the Brooklyn Dodgers, and they began to build a correspondence. They wrote, ended up writing letters back to one another from the hospitals they were in and became friends. This is at one of the Kutcher's games. Stokes was well enough to go to several of the Kutcher's games in the Catskills, and Jack would take him to up to those games. And then Lou Alcindor is behind Maurice. Maurice is in the glasses. Campanella's to his left. That's Lou Alcindor, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, and then Wilt is behind Campanella. But that's when they wheeled them out at one of the Kutcher's games. Jack also, he thought Maurice would get out of the hospital. His whole home was made wheelchair accessible, ramps put in, envisioning that he was going to move Maurice Stokes into his home with his family, his wife and his four children. Maurice was never well enough to not live in a hospital setting. But Jack had gone to that extent. Lots of stories about what Jack did. Maurice got tired of hospital food. Jack brought steaks in for him. Jack bought him a typewriter when he had gained some of the use of his fingers. This is a really powerful anecdote in the story. They had hooked Maurice's arms up in pulleys above the typewriter. They put a sheet of paper in, and the first things that he pecked out was, "Dear Jack, how can I ever thank you?" He put the letter in an envelope and gave it to him when Twyman came to visit him. But he was well enough to attend four of the benefit games, and he went from 66 to 69. Jack Twyman took him up there for that event. He came back to Pittsburgh once. in 69, and he died in 70 at the age of 36. So I made one trip back to Pittsburgh. Joseph Barr, when he came back in March of 69, called it Maurice Stokes Day. Had a presentation with the media that gave him a key to the city. He visited Westinghouse, and there was an assembly at his alma mater. Ed Fleming was there. Phelps, his former high school and St. Francis teammate, were there. Willard Fisher, his old coach, was there. And then Twyman that night took Stokes to the Round Ball Classic at the Civic Arena. And they used to play two games, one with the Pennsylvania Stars from the Public League and the Catholic League, and then stars from around the country. And between games, they recognized Maurice. And then the following day, on a Sunday, he visited his home. And John Brewer, who was one of the neighbors, oh, this is a quote I forgot to read from the games that were played at Mellon Park. I just saw him not long ago. He was at St. Francis showing his grandsons around. He's in his 80s, a guy by the name of Rip Nixon, who was from the Pittsburgh area. But he talked about the games after Mellon. They had some fun after those games. I know I'm rewinding, but I did want to read this. At the end of the day, we'd get together and figure out who was going to have the party that night, recalled Nixon. We had certain roles. First role, you had to chip in money for food and beer. Second role, you had to bring a bottle of top shelf liquor. If you came with Seagram Sevens, you weren't getting in. This is from the event at Westinghouse. Maurice, this is from his journal that Sylvia Meek would keep for him when he was working on his speech therapy. Ed gave us, so these are Maurice's words, Ed gave a speech that brought back many old memories, said Stokes. The talk given by the president of the student council was something else. When he honored my mother and father, the feeling that I had in my heart could never be described with words. And this is my writing. Now, the Westinghouse student council presented Maurice with a check for $1,000 that its members had raised for his medical bills. A school administrator announced that a scholarship fund had been established to provide financial support to a college-bound Westinghouse graduate each year. He'll be talking about this for 5 years, said Twyman. His days at Westinghouse and St. Francis College were the best of his life. But then the next day when he visited his home in Homewood, this is his neighbor John Brewer. Late Sunday morning, I sat on the city steps near the Stokes house, said Brewer. A long white limo stopped and five black and white men jumped out and began to walk up the steps to the Stokes home. They were joking and laughing joyfully as they entered the house. Even the limo driver joined them. I later heard that they were players from the Royals and the Globetrotters, players who had come to see Maurice while he was back in Pittsburgh. He also made it to St. Francis a couple of times. He was inducted into the Cambria County Athletics Hall of Fame. Jack brought him back for that, and was honored with an event on the St. Francis campus. He was not a Catholic. St. Francis is a Catholic institution. He was raised a Baptist, or Maurice was, but he had gotten to, when he was under hospital care, he had started to embrace the Catholic faith and went through the steps to become a Catholic while he was under hospital care in Cincinnati. And would often go, Jack and Carol were Catholics, and when he was well enough, he would go to Mass with them. On April 6th of 1970, he died. He was 36 years old, a little over 12 years since he had fallen in that game against the Lakers. He was such a physical specimen that he didn't, and nurses were amazed by this, some of the ones I talked to, he didn't balloon and put on a lot of weight, even though he was didn't get a lot of, he couldn't move around a lot. He worked very hard in his therapy, but he was still stationary and sedentary for large chunks of time. But he never ballooned to, a heavy weight. And so he actually, physically, he retained a lot of his muscle tone. But he suffered a heart attack and died. Jack Twyman was actually at Riverfront Stadium in Cincinnati for a baseball game. And they tried to get a hold of him, and eventually someone did get a hold of him at the ball game. He left, raced to the hospital, but he got there after Maurice had died. And His daughter, Lisa, talks about that night she saw him crying. He was a man's man. He was not a guy to show emotions. He was, very, I don't want to say rigid, but someone who was stern. And Lisa, his daughter, who actually worked as a sports writer for a little while, worked for Sports Illustrated, she talked about never seeing her father break down the way that he did. Our university had two masses to honor Stokes. Stokes actually, when he became a Catholic, he had approached the Franciscan brothers who run St. Francis, and he had asked, because he had really had a fondness for the university. This man, Vince Negerbon, who I became friends with, he's gone now, but I became friends with Vince, Father Vince, and we served on the Cambria County Athletics Hall of Fame Committee together, and would drive from our campus in Loretto down to Johnstown, and Father Vince would share a lot of stories. Vince was very close with Stokes, and Stokes had asked before he died, could I be laid to rest on your campus? And he's one of only two lay people who aren't priests that are buried on our campus, and actually not far from where my office is. I teach in, but my office is in SCOTUS Hall, and our small cemetery on campus where Stokes is laid to rest is not far from there, just less than a minute walk, really. Father Vince, who again, the book is dedicated to Father Vince, and my stepson, Logan, who we just share a love of basketball together, is dedicated to those two men. Father Vince, at one of the funeral masses, there was one that the noon classes were canceled that day, one at the noontime hour, the bigger one, and then an evening vigil for students. And actually, Oscar Robertson came back for the funeral, and he found out he was traded while he was at St. Francis for Stokes' funeral. But Father Vince, if I could say anything about him, I'd like to draw a parallel between Maurice and St. Francis of Assisi himself. When you talk about mortal human beings and a saint, you're treading on dangerous ground, but I know of no more striking parallel than these two men. So he was laid to rest. They actually had a small service at the hospital. Good Samaritan Hospital was his last stop. St. Elizabeth was his first. Then he moved to Christ Hospital. And then Good Samaritan, they had better therapy facilities and therapists who were very well-versed in what Maurice needed. He spent his last years at Good Samaritan Hospital. And they had a service there before they transported him. He landed in Johnstown. You can't really see well, but Maurice's casket, and then the gentleman on the far right is Twyman, and then Oscar, the big O, is you can kind of see his tie there, rode out with the body from Cincinnati, and he was laid to rest at our college and now university. Jack would have Twyman, Jack would have Maurice over for Sunday dinner when he was well enough, oftentimes. And on one of those occasions, Father Vince, who I became friends with, he had contacted Twyman and said, hey, we're going to build a new athletics facility and we want to put Maurice's name on it. And what do you think? And he goes, I think it's a great idea. And he said, and Jack said, well, let's surprise him. He goes, I'll tell him we're coming over for Sunday brunch, and you and one of the boosters are the booster club president, Larry Giacobbe. Why don't you come to my house? You can hide in the basement, and once we get Maurice in, you guys can spring, come up and pose the question. And so Vince, he was a card. He went along with it. They brought Carol and Jack went over and bought Maurice over for dinner, and they actually had a camera going. And Father Vince comes up, and Maurice is taken aback, and he's in his wheelchair, and he says, "We're building a new athletics facility on campus, and Larry and I are here to ask you if we could name the facility in your honor." And the video, tears start to stream down Maurice's eyes. And he didn't feel he was worthy of it, ultimately agreed. And the facility that we play in today, our men's and women's basketball teams, our natatorium where our swim team competes, is the Maurice Stokes Athletic Center, and it was dedicated on December 8, 1972. Ray Berner, who was one of Stokes' classmates, said in dedicating his new field house, "It ensures with as much permanence as a human institution can ensure that the name of Maurice Stokes will live on in Loretto." Since then, our school's athletic booster club, fundraising arm for our athletics department, was named the Stokes Club after Maurice. He was inducted into our university's Hall of Fame in its inaugural class in 1996. As I mentioned, I arrived at the school in 1999 as the sports information director. We retired his jersey in 2000. That was the first opportunity for me to meet Jack Twyman, who came back for that event. And then he only played 3 years in the NBA. But if you look at his rebounding average, obviously his total isn't going to be up there with the Dennis Rodmans and the Bob Pettits and the Carl Malones and the Charles Barkleys. But his average, and I have an appendix in the back of my book in which it lists the averages, he's right near the top of the list, behind Russell and Chamberlain. And then it's Maurice Stokes in terms of average rebounds per game. So he didn't have a large body of work, obviously, because he fell in his at the end of his third season. But Jack Twyman, who is an inductee in the Naismith Hall of Fame in his own right as a player, he lobbied the Veterans Committee to put Maurice in. And when I was there as Sports Information Director, we did get word that he was finally a member. He was with Clyde Drexler, was one of his fellow inductees. What was the other big name? There was a handful of NBA players who went in with him. Jack accepted the award, delivered a beautiful, and Oscar Robertson was there. He also spoke on Twyman's, he and Twyman spoke on Maurice's behalf. You have a jacket, a ring, and a plaque. Twyman accepted those at Maurice's induction ceremony, and then in an event at the hotel the following morning, the event was on a Saturday, on Sunday morning, he gave those over to our former president, Father Gabe Zeiss, and those Hall of Fame materials are on display in the Maurice Stokes Athletic Center today. And as you can see, I just mentioned the small body of work he had, the fewest number of games played of anyone in the National Basketball Association. When I was out for Jack's funeral, when he died in 2012, in the Cincinnati newspaper, the day of the funeral service, there was a story, and the sports writer talked to Jesse Jackson, and Jackson had challenged the NBA to create an award to recognize the selflessness that Jack Twyman demonstrated on behalf of a fallen teammate. And again, David Stern, the commissioner, a former commissioner of the National Basketball Association, never specifically indicated that that was the driving force behind the creation of the award. But the following summer, Jack died in May of 2012, and the following year, the NBA introduced its Stokes Twyman Teammate of the Year Award, and the first recipient of it was Chauncey Billups, who's right here. This is Jay Twyman, who is Jack's son, one of his sons, and this is the former NBA commissioner, David Stern. Billups was the first winner. Shane Battier, a former player now retired from the Miami Heat, was the winner in 2014. And then Tim Duncan, who is placed with the San Antonio Spurs, was the recipient of the award. And I don't know how well you see it, but the award itself is someone helping someone off the floor. Theoretically, this being Twyman helping Maurice Stokes. And Jay Twyman, he was actually back at the Stokes Center last year. I ran into him. His son plays for the University at Albany, and they were playing St. Francis. So Jay had come up, and we sat together and watched the game. He lives in New York. And so I deliver this presentation to a lot of different groups, and one of the groups that I often talk to are kids at basketball camps. So I don't go into this depth of detail, but I do always talk about, okay, so what qualities do these people demonstrate? And if I had to if I can only choose one adjective to talk about what Maurice Stokes exhibited, would be perseverance. I mean, the guy was dealt a bad hand. He had the cat by the tail. He was the rookie of the year in the league. He was making good money by the standards of the league at the time. And then like that, I mean, it turned. It did a 180 on the guy. And like I said, he didn't approach it with, you know, optimism right away. He thought he was going to get better. He realized he wasn't. But he made the most of it. He didn't sulk over the last 12 years of his life, from the fall in 58 till his passing in 70. He worked to get better, and it was really incremental. It was small, the improvements that he made, but he persevered. There's some of the ceramic, the stuff that he made for the nurses, the people I talked to at the hospitals in Cincinnati, the smiles that they had when I told them I was here to talk about Maurice Stokes. Perseverance is the message that, you know, I talk to basketball campers and say, you're going to have bad games, you're going to go 0-10, you're going to turn the ball over, but you have to persevere through that. And then I also talk to them about the qualities that Jack Twyman demonstrates, and that's selflessness. I mean, this is a guy, again, he's 24 years old, and he's going up to Maurice Stokes' mother and asking her if he can be his legal guardian. That family, by the way, they had four children. I mentioned Harry. He was killed in a car accident outside of Washington, PA, while Stokes was at school at St. Francis. And then in a really bizarre situation, Clarice, Maurice died in April of 1970. Clarice, who was healthy, she was a nurse in the Pittsburgh area, she died within a month of Maurice, which that whole twin connection, it was very odd. So the Myrtle and Tara Stokes, they buried three of their four children, which is a terrible thing to have to do. Taro Jr. is still alive, lives in the Chicago area. But what Jack exhibited was selflessness. I mean, this was a guy that he did not, he used his platform. When he retired from the National Basketball Association, the one thing that he lamented quite a bit was that he wouldn't have that platform to share the story of Maurice Stokes, to try to keep raising money for Stokes. The game at Kutcher's continued. Stokes died in 70. They continued that game for a number of years, and then it turned into a celebrity golf tournament, and they put Stokes and Chamberlain's names both on it. It lasted for quite a while. I'm not sure when the basketball game became the golf tournament. The golf tournament finished in like 2008, 2009. When I interviewed Jack for the book, when they ended the golf tournament, there was still some money in that account, that Kutcher's account, and Mark Kutcher, who I interviewed for the book, Milton and Helen Kutcher's son, talked to Jack and said, "What should we do with this money?" And Jack said, "I know what we should do with it. We should donate it to St. Francis, because St. Francis meant so much to Maurice." And actually, we renovated the locker rooms for both our basketball teams and created new office suites in the Stokes Athletic Center with the remaining money in that fund from the Kutcher's account. But Jack embodies selflessness, and that's what I tell the campers when I deliver a presentation to them. Hey, help your teammate. You know, if it's a simple thing of going and helping him off the floor when he goes down, helping him with his shot in the offseason, being that someone. And that's the theme that our St. Francis Athletics Department has adopted, is become that someone. We have T-shirts. We created a logo that we use, and all of our student athletes at the start of each year get a become that someone T-shirt. Be that person that Jack Twyman was for Maurice Stokes. And interestingly, the book came out last April, and this was really uncanny. The first game for both for St. Francis men's basketball team was against the University of Cincinnati, the two men's alma maters. And so I thought that was kind of neat that, and it wasn't planned. I got the schedule from the basket, it was, I don't know how I came across it, but I saw, oh my. The book came out in April, and we played at the University of Cincinnati in November. I actually went out and had a book signing. Lisa Twyman, Jack's daughter, and her grandson came by, and it was neat that the book came out, and then the first game featured the two men's alma maters. And thank you. Thanks for letting me have the opportunity to come out here and talk and share a little bit about my book.
Any questions? Yes. I'm just curious. Very early, you mentioned the National Industrial Basketball League as like one of the competitors for good college basketball talent. And can you provide it? I mean, were these like big corporations that teams or something like
exactly
that actually played in the league? It was almost like an NBA competitor, even, really.
The NBA was in its infancy, and you had these Caterpillar Corporation sponsored basketball teams. They worked, quote, theoretically worked for the companies, and they played for these corporations. And a pretty high level of basketball between the Globetrotters, the National Basketball Association, and the industrial leagues.
Fort Wayne
had industrial. Yeah, there were a lot of
Phillips 66.
They were all the company names.
And they had like a full season.
That's correct.
Huh. That's interesting.
And the NBA did not have the corner on the market then in terms of securing the talented players. And they offered a lot of money too. The NBA, I mean, Les Harrison had to pony up some money to lure Stokes away from those leagues.
Anything else?
Yes.
Didn't they start in the 40s?
The NBA, you had the NBL, the National Basketball League, and you had the ABA, and those two leagues consolidated to form the NBA with, I think, three or four years before Stokes got there. So it was the early 50s.
What was it in 40? What league was that?
It was the National Basketball League, the NBL.
That was the main one back then?
Correct.
That's all I hope it said, started 1945.
Well, I mean, they could maybe count the National Basketball League years as the NBA, but...
The only reason I know it's 45 is Pittsburgh was here 1 year. Now it is.
Okay.
That's what I was wondering about.
Yeah, it would have been the National Basketball League at the time.
Yeah, they formed after 1 year. Mm-hmm. And they had, you know, his...
But I like to, yeah...
I just
think it's a lost story about two men that have... their roots here in Pittsburgh, and so many years have passed that while people were aware of the story, you know, through the national publications, so many years have passed and the story, I think, got away from us. Especially this isn't a basketball town, too, without a professional presence. It's become more of a college basketball city with, you know, obviously what Ben Howland and Jamie Dixon have done with the Panthers, but that... these two prominent figures in NBA history, I think some of their story gets lost. And that's why I reached out to Mike, quite frankly, to try to get out here and share the story with folks in the Pittsburgh area.
Yes. Well, just a couple things I wanted to mention. Well, one of the leagues, I think, was the BAA at the time, somewhere in there.
The BAA, yes.
Basketball.
I said the ABA, the BAA and the NBA.
Mid-late 40s. And did Cal Fowler, was he at, went to Oliver High School, was he at...
played at St. Francis.
Was he with...
he was later.
He was a year or two later.
Yeah, more than that even. Calvin Fowler played at Oliver and then ended up playing ball at St. Francis. Wonderful man. He died not too long ago, actually.
And, I was just going to mention, I don't know if you mentioned this at the beginning, Jack Twyman went to Central Catholic, but he grew up in the West End somewhere, Crafton or... The Canterbury Catholic did not exist.
He grew in Sheridan District.
Somewhere down that way.
Yeah.
So he traveled from the West End to...
to go to Central, correct. Yeah, his mother wanted him to have a Catholic school education. And so he grew up in Sheridan and had to... he had quite a commute to get over to Central Catholic.
Yeah, I mean, that's...
his younger brother played 4 years at Central. Ned.
Yeah. Went to Notre Dame and then came back to Duquesne. Ned Twyman did. Another player, while we're talking, I mentioned Cal Fowler, Norm Van Leer also played at St. Francis, if anyone remembers that name, who played with the Bulls. Kevin Porter, who was a great point guard. He was a We've had some pretty good players over the years that went through St. Francis. Any other questions? Well, thanks again. I really appreciate the opportunity to talk to you guys. And I'm happy to check with you one-on-one afterwards.
Books are available, $25 there. We also have books on the Bridges of Pittsburgh and Jewish Pittsburgh. Please help me out and take chairs in the back. We'll hang them up. Our next meeting is on stained glass and design in the East End and Glenn Green stained glass works. Someone asked you, please think about joining us. Thank you very much for coming.